One of the most popular questions that I'm asked is, what is the best genetic genealogy website? And the answer really depends on what it is you want to get out of your DNA test. Today, I'm going to give you my updated review of what I think the best genetic genealogy website is. Howdy, I'm Andy Lee with Family History Fanatics, where we help you understand your DNA, climb your family tree, and write the story of your ancestors along the way. Today, we're talking about genetic genealogy websites. And what are the criteria that make a really good website? Well, let me first preface this whole video by saying it really depends on you. And so as you're seeing my ratings, it may be different for you. And I encourage you to go to the spreadsheet that I have linked in the description and change the numbers up based on your personal preferences to see which website you think is the best. There are three major criteria that I think make a good genetic genealogy website. The very first one is matches. If you're doing genetic genealogy, you need to match with other people. DNA by itself is of no use. You need to have somebody else's DNA to see if you match. And so the number of matches plays a big role in how good of a genetic genealogy website it is. Now, the second thing is the tools. If all you can do is see matches, then you're not going to get much out of it. You have to have some tools to be able to do different types of comparisons, to see who you share in common with, all sorts of different things. So the tools that websites offer is another big component of genetic genealogy. And the last one is collaboration. Really, all of genealogy should be a big pool of collaboration. We all have information and we're all related. We're all researching ancestors that interconnect with other people. So there's got to be a way to collaborate with other people on a genetic genealogy website. Otherwise, you're just doing it in a silo and you're probably not going to get as much out of it as you would with collaboration. So in 2018 and 2019, I did a couple of reviews of the different websites and came up with who my winners were for each year. And so this year's no different, but there's going to be changes. Just like every year, I'm refining my formula. Some things don't mean as much to me. And so it's a little bit hard to compare from year to year, but let me go over some of the changes from the 2019 formula. First off, I removed the multiple kit criteria and the phasing criteria. Now, this is not to say that these two things were not important, because they're still, you know, somewhat important. But when I look at it from a, you know, what do I do for genetic genealogy? They're not that important and they're not used as much. And that may be because from a phasing standpoint, I've already got everything situated between my paternal and my maternal side as far as who matches who. And then there's other methods that are better than just a simple maternal-paternal phasing, for instance, like the Leeds method or clustering now, that allow you to group your matches in much more compact and much better forms than just separating out maternal and paternal. But that's a good starting place, but it's not going to have a place in my formula anymore, at least not this year. Maybe I'll add it back in next year. Now, the next thing is I changed the weighting factor, how much each of these criteria is worth to the overall score. And I've played around with this a lot, and I'm still not fully satisfied with where I have it, but I think it reflects something close to what, you know, in my actual practice, I think is most important. Now that some of these companies are getting to have large databases, one of the things that I'm noticing is the increase in size doesn't always reflect more matches to me. Now, this is because some of these companies are doing a lot of outreach to places of the world where I don't have any close relatives or at least ancestors that might be within the last 10 generations. For instance, the databases start up really focused on the United States is where most of the people were from. And the United States primarily is made up of different populations from Europe that immigrated over, as well as some of the Native American populations and some sub-Saharan African populations. One of the major populations that wasn't represented really well was the Asian populations, and that is more than half of the population of the world. So as these databases grow in size, as they do outreach to Asia, I'm not going to necessarily see any matches, even though this database size is increasing, and it can increase enormously without really affecting my matches. And so I've arbitrarily limited the database size. And the last thing is I've updated, of course, each of the website's ratings for each one of the categories. They've all had different changes over the last year, where they've added some features and some features have been taken away. And so I've had to relook at each one of these and decide on what the new rating is going to be. So let's start off and let's describe something that is really important for genealogy. I mentioned it already, and that is collaboration. Now, collaboration is not a category that I'm awarding points to in and of itself, but collaboration affects a couple of the other categories. So what do I mean by collaboration? I mean how much genealogical activity is happening on these sites, and it's different for every website because each website doesn't necessarily have the same focus. For instance, Ancestry and MyHeritage started off as tree websites and the DNA was added later. On the other hand, 23andMe started off as a DNA website and they've had a tree before with MyHeritage and then that was gotten rid of and now they've got a new tree functionality. So you can see that this is actually a little bit difficult to create a criteria between these different websites. And it's really loosely based on tree activity, how many people put trees in, and whether or not those trees have enough people that you might be able to find a common match from. But I'll be honest, this figure is pretty much, it's gonna change greatly between person to person. So if you go again to the spreadsheet and see how I calculated it, you can pull up your own information and you might come up with vastly different numbers, and that's okay. Now what this resulted for me was it created a multiplier from about 0.25 to about 0.62 that I'm using with the number of matches and the quality matches, which I'll get to in a second. And basically what this does is this actually brings those two numbers down more so that they are comparable with some of the other criteria. Let's get started and go through each one of the criteria and who the winner of that category was so we can find out who the overall best genetic genealogy company is. The first one is database size. I said at the beginning that matches are important, and then database size then is going to have to be important. It constitutes 25% of your overall score. And what I'm doing for this is I'm taking the number of millions of kits in that database and multiplying it by that collaboration score. And that's going to give me a value that is added into the total score. I mentioned before that I limited this to about 13 million kits because what I'm saying is you know, beyond that, I'm not seeing as much matches as I would otherwise. And I think it is because these companies are doing more outreach, which is great for those people who are from some of those populations in Africa and the Middle East and in Asia where we haven't had a lot of testing already. So which company ended up with the best score here? Well, you probably guessed it, and that is Ancestry. Now, Ancestry has the largest database, and they also have a fairly active population that puts trees on their databases, links that DNA to trees, and so they end up with a score of 5.3. So good job to Ancestry. You're the winner of this category. The next category is called the quality match, and this is something that I made up myself, and it is 40%. It is the most important attribute of a database. So when you're thinking about, you know, where you want to go, one of the things to look for is quality match. Now, what do I mean by a quality match? Well, I mean that it is the number of matches between 35 centimorgans and 600 centimorgans. That means that there's a likelihood you're going to be able to find out how you are related within a genealogical time frame. Now, it doesn't mean that if there's matches less than this, you're not going to find out how you're related. It's just that this group of matches is much more likely that you're going to be able to identify that specific relationship. Now, the quality match score is created by taking the number of quality matches and dividing it by the millions of kits in the database. So if you have more quality matches with a smaller database, you can actually have a very high quality match score. One thing to bear in mind is if you're using family tree DNA data, you need to make sure that you actually correct that by removing out these small segments. So for instance, you may have some matches that look like they are 70, 80, 100, maybe even 150 centimorgans, but once you remove out those small matches, they may only be 20 or 30 centimorgans. That's a big difference because it goes from a quality match to just one of your lower centimorgan matches. So before you use the family tree data, then make sure you correct that information. And the winner of the quality match score actually is family tree, despite the fact that you actually have to correct for the amount of centimorgans that they're reporting. They still have the highest quality match score and they get a score of 1.78 in the quality match category. So congratulations to family tree DNA for winning this category. One caveat I'm going to mention though is Family Tree DNA is the only company that does not report their database size. Now, I use the database sizes based on Leia Larkin's most recent blog about what the sizes of the different databases are. Family Tree DNA information is estimated around 1.15 million. Turns out that that's actually provides a quality match score that's double what almost all the other companies are. So it could be that Family Tree DNA's database size is actually closer to 2 to 2.5 million. Unless they actually release those numbers, we're just gonna have to go off of their estimate. So the next category is triangulation. Now, I've talked about triangulation a lot. There's several videos on this channel about triangulation. I like to teach people about triangulation. This constitutes 15% of the overall score, and it's because it is a really powerful tool to verify that you have matches who are related to a common ancestor. So what is this score made up of? It's really the ability to triangulate segments on that website. So when you start thinking about this, you got to have a chromosome browser to be able to actually see that segment data. Some of the companies actually have some automatic triangulation that is very helpful for it, and that of course increases their score. So who's going to be the winner? Well, it's actually GEDmatch is the winner. They get a score of 3, and that's just because they have several different tools, all that can be used for triangulation. And some of these tools are free. Some of them you can pay for on their tier 1. But you can triangulate segments with any of your kits with other people on GEDmatch. And that's why they get a score of 3. The next category is the transfer category. This is actually one I was toying with taking out of the whole equation, but I decided to leave it in for now because it is a great money-saving opportunity. If you've tested at Ancestry and 23andMe, they don't allow transfers, so the only way to get into those databases is to test with them. So you're paying for the regular cost of a DNA kit. However, to get into the GEDmatch and the FamilyTree DNA and the MyHeritage DNA databases, you can transfer in for free. Now, some of them limit you as to the number of tools, but for just a small fee, which is not as much as the cost of a new kit, you can have full access to all of those websites. So then this is based on the ability to transfer in and to use tools. And so unfortunately, 23andMe and Ancestry, they both get a 0 for this category because they don't allow that transfer. But who's the winner? Well, it's GEDmatch again. And this is because while you can transfer in for free for the others, they usually only give you matches for that transfer kit. With GEDmatch, you still get to use all of their free tools, which you would be able to use no matter what. Now, you can also upgrade for the tier 1 tools if you want, sort of like you can pay for that transfer kit to be able to access tools on Family Tree DNA and MyHeritage. But for right now, I'm giving GEDmatch a score of 2, which wins them this category. The last category, this is my favorite, I like to call the X factor. And this is 15% of the overall score. And the X factor is great because I can make it whatever I want. And you can make it whatever you want to. But for me, I look at all the different tools on the website, how they integrate together, and how you can use those in genetic genealogy. So which website's going to win? I think this should be obvious that it's GEDmatch. GEDmatch, hands down, has the most amount of tools when you're talking about the free ones or when you're talking about the paid ones. They do lots of things, and in several cases, they do things in many different ways so that while you may not be able to find your match, or you may not be able to find the exact relationship using a certain tool, there may be another tool that you can use to help you with that. They also have a lot of tools that nobody else has. And so, hands down, I think GEDmatch wins this X Factor category with a score of 3. Let me point out, though, this is not to say that the other companies don't all have their advantages, because they do. So I'd encourage you to go and take a look at what extra things you can get with each one of the different companies. So that is all of the different categories. Now, you may be thinking, well, which websites did you actually look at? And I've limited it right now to 6 websites: Living DNA, Family Tree DNA, MyHeritage, Ancestry, 23andMe, and GEDmatch. Now, most of those, 5 of those, in fact, all are testing companies, and one of them is not. It's just a third-party tools. In the future, I plan on adding other companies like Borland Genetics or DNA Land. But right now, because the size of their database just does not allow that many matches to show up, I find the websites are great for certain individual things, but just as a general, I haven't decided to add them in yet. So with that said, let's go through our countdown of which company is the best, starting with number 6. And number 6 right now, I'd say, is Living DNA. Now, Living DNA is one of the newest companies. I just did a review video a few weeks ago on Living DNA, and they're still, you know, having some bumps as they get out of the gate there. I've got 1 match. So when you think about genetic genealogy, if you only have 1 match, or like my wife, 0 matches, it's very difficult to do genetic genealogy without any matches. So Living DNA needs to increase the size of their database. They need to get their matching algorithms better if they want to be able to move up this list. Let's go on to number 2, which is Family Tree DNA. Now, Family Tree DNA won one of those categories, but unfortunately, some of the other categories they fell behind on, particularly in their database size, which was 25% of the overall score. They are the smallest of the databases. Now, again, this is based on estimated values, so it's possible that if they released what their actual database size, then they would be larger and they might get a better score. But for right now, I'm just going off of the estimated values because I don't have anything else to go off of. So they come in at number 5. And that's going to lead us now to number 3. Now you say, what about number 4? Well, we got a tie for a third. 2 companies ended up with the exact same score. And those 2 are 23andMe and GEDmatch. And these are 2 companies I use a lot. They have a lot of tools. They have good matching. 23andMe is actually the 2nd largest database. They've been around, and I think they were the original ones that did autosomal testing as well. So 23andMe and GEDmatch tie for 3rd place. In 2nd place, I know the tension's just mounting. Who's going to win? Well, it's MyHeritage. Now, this may be a surprise for many of you, because when I was going through each one of the categories, MyHeritage did not show up on there. However, MyHeritage was usually in 2nd place in almost all of these categories. And so just because they are not number 1 in anything yet, doesn't mean that overall they don't still get a really high score. And in MyHeritage's case, they do. Now, their database has been growing. It's about, I think, twice the amount of DNA kits as there were a year. Last time I did this review, a little over a year ago. So I expect that they're going to continue to increase their score, and they may take the number 1 spot in 2021. We'll have to see. So that leaves number 1, and who's going to be number 1? It's Ancestry. For the 2nd year in a row, I'm actually rating Ancestry as the best genetic genealogy website. And really the reason is because of their massive database and the massive amount of people that are building trees, that are, you know, attaching that DNA to trees. And so there is a lot of collaboration in it. And those 2, the quality match score and the database size score, while they're related, they do look at different things. But that's 65% of your overall score, and Ancestry was the top in one of them and near the top in one of the others. So they get the number 1 spot in 2020. If you haven't tested with Ancestry, I'd encourage you to test with Ancestry. Now that I've given you my ratings, why don't you put in the comments below which company you think is the best? Is it 23andMe, MyHeritage, Living DNA, Family Tree DNA, Ancestry, GEDmatch, or one of the other companies that I haven't even rated on here? I mentioned a couple of things in this video. If you want to see how to correct your family tree DNA, then go to this video up here. And if you want to see my last review of the different companies, then just go to this video right down here. And make sure that you subscribe to this channel and click on the bell if you want to be notified about upcoming episodes.